Hello and welcome to Background Briefing, available 24/7 at backgroundbriefing.org. I'm Ian Masters, and today we'll look into a number of stories and issues in the news. We'll begin with the devastation that Hurricane Ida has left in its path across Louisiana, with the state's electricity grid in tatters after powerful winds knocked out all 8 electric transmission lines feeding New Orleans. Joining us is Mark Schleifstein, a reporter with the New Orleans Times-Picayune, who won a Pulitzer Prize in 1997, then another, as well as a George Polk Award in 2008 for his coverage of Hurricane Katrina. The co-author with John McQuaid of Path of Destruction, The Devastation of New Orleans, and The Coming Age of Superstorms, we will discuss how the levees surrounding the city of New Orleans, which is below sea level, are at best 32 feet high, and that due to global warming and sea level rise, future storms will overcome the multi-billion dollar protective system now in place. Then we'll speak with Najmuddin Meshkati, a professor in the Department of Civil Environmental Engineering and the Department of Industrial and Systems Engineering at the University of Southern California, where he's an expert on safety and risk reductions for energy generation plants, petrochemical plants and refineries, and transmission and distribution grids. He joins us to discuss the damage to Louisiana's power grid as another example of the weaknesses of the country's electrical systems. With blackouts in Texas last winter and fires in California last summer, and at this moment caused by the PG&E grid, these failures expose the fragility of the nation's grid and the need to deal with extreme weather as a new normal, as well as the decentralization of the grid to the level of self-sustaining household generation. Then finally, we'll examine further the inconclusive report from the United States intelligence community on the origins of the COVID pandemic and discuss what can be done in the face of a refusal by the Chinese Communist government to cooperate and provide evidence as their propaganda apparatus pumps out conspiracy theories blaming the U.S. for creating a bioweapon, which apparently we used against ourselves, given the U.S. has the world's highest death toll. Dr. Stanley Perlman, a professor of microbiology and immunology at the University of Iowa, who has studied coronavirus pathogenesis for 4 decades, joins us. And joining us now is Mark Schleifstein, who is a reporter for the New Orleans Times-Picayune, where he has deep experience in covering Gulf Coast science issues. He and his colleague John McQuaid won a Pulitzer Prize in 1997 for a series on the world's oceans. And in 2002, he won several awards for their series, Washing Away, How South Louisiana is Growing More Vulnerable to a Catastrophic Hurricane. And after the catastrophic Hurricane Katrina hit, Schleifstein reports were among the most honored with the Pulitzer Prize and the George Polk Award in 2006, and he and McQuaid also won a special award from the American Geophysical Union for their reporting on coastal science issues, and together they wrote the book Path of Destruction, The Devastation of New Orleans and the Coming Age of Superstorms. Welcome to Background Briefing, Mark Schleifstein.
Thank you. I'm glad to be here.
Well, I'm glad that we can actually talk to you
evening.
Because the grid is down and I guess the cell towers are still working. So as long as we can, let's talk, Mark. First of all, your book, of course, is The Coming Age of Superstorms. Well, the age of superstorms is upon us, right?
It is indeed. That's really a problem. And the concerns that we had yesterday with this storm really had to do with storm surge and its winds. There's no question, research since we wrote the book has confirmed that storms are occurring, maybe not more frequently yet at the moment, but those that do occur are more intense, sometimes a category or two more intense than they might have been. And because of other climate change issues, especially sea level rise, the storm surge that they push ahead of them can be much higher along coastal areas. I think we may have been hit significantly by storm surge last night. We're still trying to figure out exactly what the breadth of that damage was. One of the fortunate things here is that in the city of New Orleans, our levee system rebuilt after Hurricane Katrina was high enough to protect us from the surge, from the storm that came in on the particular path that it did come in on, but there are areas that are outside of our levee system south of us that were overwhelmed by that storm surge. And that's going to be a problem that we're going to be dealing with in the future.
But this storm, Ida, as it headed towards the Gulf, it increased in intensity quite rapidly. And by the time it hit landfall, it was what, Category 4 or 5?
Right. It was a Category 4, just under 5. It was 150 miles an hour, and 5 begins at 157. And the reason for its rapid intensification was that it was, you know, perfect conditions for spinning up a storm. There's no real upper level winds to knock off the clouds and reduce its ability to gain the thunderstorms around its center. And then it went over warm water in the Gulf of Mexico. Now, each year, a portion of the Gulf Stream breaks off and sort of moves around the Gulf of Mexico. And that Gulf Stream water is much warmer and deep. So it's like 200 feet deep as opposed to the 1 or 2 feet of warm water on the surface. So when it hit that, I mean, that's basically like just turning up the burner under a hurricane. It just really increases its ability of gaining strength. And so it went over quite a bit of that water as it moved towards shore. And there was just nothing that was going to stop it from intensifying. It intensified until actually it stayed at 150 even after it had made its initial landfall on the Barrier Islands and as it moved inland through Barataria Bay.
But hasn't the temperature of the waters in the Gulf gone up? I think it's 6 degrees in the last century.
That's been a problem as well. I'm not quite sure of the specifics on how much it's gone up, but like everywhere else in the world, sea temperatures have increased. But again, for this particular storm, the fact that you had 200 feet of the way this usually happens is that when a hurricane goes over a portion of the Gulf of Mexico, it uses up the heat in that 1 or 2 feet, and then it's dragging cooler water from deeper. And it didn't have the ability of doing that this time because the deep water was just as hot, or hotter, because it was Gulf Stream water that was coming in. So it's a significant issue. Both things are true, is what it amounts to, both sort of natural effects and the climate change effects in the Gulf.
And again, I'm speaking with Mark Schleifstein, who is a reporter for the New Orleans Times-Picayune. He has deep experience covering Gulf Coast science issues, and he and his colleague John McQuaid won a Pulitzer Prize in 1997 for a series on the world's oceans. In 2002, he won several awards for their series Washing Away, How South Louisiana is Growing More Vulnerable to a Catastrophic Hurricane. And after the catastrophic Hurricane Katrina hit, Schleifstein's reports were among those honored with the Pulitzer Prize and the George Polk Award in 2006. And he and McQuaid also won a special award from the American Geophysical Union for their reporting on coastal science issues. And together they wrote the book Path of Destruction, The Devastation of New Orleans and the Coming Age of Superstorms. But given the work that you and John McQuaid have done, Mark Schleifstein, and your book, Warning, Path of Destruction, The Devastation of New Orleans and the Coming Age of Superstorms, is there a kind of gap between the scientific knowledge of the effects of global warming and the kind of people that run the electric grids in this country? I mean, we had last winter in Texas, the grid crashed because it wasn't prepared for the extreme weather, and it seems the same thing is happening now in Louisiana. So is there a gap there between scientific knowledge and the kind of technical infrastructure that we have and the people who man it?
I think that there is indeed. Entergy Corporation, the major company that is involved here, has had significant problems. I mean, it had problems during Hurricane Katrina as well. The reality is that the major transmission lines are on these huge towers that connect one place to another. And we had eight of those major transmission lines basically knocked down for this storm, which is going to cause real problems for the company to get back up to speed and move things along. I mean, they're talking about 3 weeks for restoration of power at a minimum, and it might very well take longer than that. How they're going to be required to deal with these kinds of continuous threats in the future across the nation is something that I think they're going to have to deal with as we move forward. I know the Biden administration in their infrastructure plan has been trying to deal with that to make utilities more responsive to other kinds of energy rather than traditional natural gas-fired energy. And as part of that process, it's dealing with the transmission between different systems. And so hopefully they'll be dealing with this issue as they move forward with that.
Well, the winds apparently wreaked havoc with power lines and transmission lines. And there's also real problems. The Sewer and Water Board of New Orleans have lost power, and they're relying, I guess, on their backup generators. They can drain the storm water out of the city and bring the drinking water in. And 84 sewage pumping stations are also without power. So that sounds
That's also been a problem. The Sewage and Water Board has been trying to deal with that problem for, really since Katrina, again, so 16 years, and has not succeeded yet. It's been day to day with them on being able to have enough electricity to deal with this. One of the things that they've been working on, ironically, is providing the opportunity for Entergy to provide them with some of that power. Obviously, that would not have helped much during this situation. The fact that they were able to keep as much power going as possible, probably that plus the fact that as intense as the rainfall was from this storm, it's probably not as much in the city itself as was expected. I think those two issues as well have probably limited the amount of flooding that we've seen, although we have seen some flooding in the city.
But the transmission lines that are feeding Orleans, Jefferson, St. Bernard, and Plaquemines parishes, as well as parts of St. Charles and Terrebonne parishes, they're all down. Are they back up now?
No. And again, most of those areas are served by Entergy, and Entergy is not expecting to have power restored for several weeks. So it's going to be a while. Some areas, like the city of New Orleans, they're hoping that they maybe will be able to get one of those eight transmission lines up and running a bit more quickly, but it's still going to be a while.
So the fact that the city is below sea level, I mean, parts of the Netherlands are like that as well, you get the feeling that with the prognosis of global warming and sea level rise, such as it is, what kind of future is there for that city, your city? I mean, are you just going to have to wall yourself in?
Well, we are now walled in. I mean, that's the reality, is that the hurricane levee system around New Orleans acts as a wall. In some areas, it's 32 feet high. That is only going to, you know, they're only going to have to elevate that in the future. That 32-foot high portion of the wall will probably be okay for the next 50 years. But beyond that, it's anybody's guess with what sea level rise is going to do. The Army Corps of Engineers right now is working on a plan for continuing to elevate the levees over the next 50 years, which they expect will cost another at least $3 billion to do that. But at the same time, that levee system is really not adequate. If Ida had been on a bit different path and had come in at a bit more to the east, The storm surge may have been enough to overtop the levees, and that will continue to be a concern. The levees are built to standards set by the National Flood Insurance Program, rather than the reality of what is needed to protect the huge investment, more than $200 billion worth of infrastructure within the levee system. The Corps itself recognizes that. It gives the New Orleans levee system its second worst rating of high risk, just because of the amount of infrastructure that is at risk from an even worse storm. If this had been a Category 5 and on the right path, pushing, you know, 20 feet of storm surge in, it would have overtopped a lot of the levee system on the southern side of the city.
So how much of the levee system is at 32 feet?
Not much. The it's about 15 miles on the east side, but that's the area that right now is closest to water. The levee system is elevated to different heights based on where they are in the system. So it will never be one height all around. It will always be different depending on what is in front of those levees.
So there's reports, of course, of the reverse flow of the Mississippi. How significant is that?
Right. So this time it wasn't a problem. What that is that storm surge making its way up the river. And in New Orleans, the river level got to 11.5 feet from about 4 feet. And I'm sure that under different circumstances, if this storm had been earlier in the year, when the river is much higher in New Orleans, like in 2019, the river was at 20 feet. If it were at 20 feet yesterday and you had the same kind of storm surge, you may have had flooding directly in the city of New Orleans on the east bank at a time maybe 6 or 7 feet above that 20-foot level, and that may have put water over the levees on the east bank for a part of this part of the area within the city and caused significant problems.
Well, just in the last couple of minutes, Mark Schleifstein, we're early in the hurricane season, aren't we?
Yes, we are. And in fact, another storm just spun up in the Caribbean this morning. So we're not through with the hurricane season yet. Last year was a good example of that. We had 5 landfalls in Louisiana of storms, including Hurricane Laura, which was another 150-mile-an-hour storm that hit Lake Charles.
So I don't hope that I talk to you again about that, but I might have to, right? Revisit you sometime later this year?
There's always that chance. If I'm still around, I may be doing this for quite a while.
Well, I thank you very much for joining us here today, Mark Schleifstein.
Well, thank you. Appreciate the opportunity.
And again, I've been speaking with Mark Schleifstein, who's a reporter for the New Orleans Times-Picayune. He has deep experience in covering Gulf Coast science issues. He and his colleague John McQuaid won a Pulitzer Prize in 1997 for a series on the world's oceans. And in 2002, he won several awards for their series, Washing Away, How South Louisiana is Growing More Vulnerable to a Catastrophic Hurricane. And after the catastrophic Hurricane Katrina hit, Schleifstein's reports were among those honored with the Pulitzer Prize and the George Polk Award in 2006. And he and McQuaid also won a special award from the American Geophysical Union for their reporting on coastal science issues. And together they wrote the book Path of Destruction, The Devastation of New Orleans and the Coming Age of Superstorms. We're going to take a brief station break. We're back discussing the damage to Louisiana's power grid as another example of the weakness of the nation's electrical grids.
Time's high and it's rhymes.
Welcome back. I'm Ian Masters, and this is Background Briefing, available 24/7 at backgroundbriefing.org. And joining us now is Naj Mashkati, who's a professor at the Sunny Astani Department of Civil Environmental Engineering and a professor in the Daniel J. Epstein Department of Industrial and Systems Engineering at the University of Southern California, where he's an expert on safety and risk reduction in such systems as the five modes of transportation and their facilities, energy generation plants, petrochemical plants and refineries, transmissions and distribution grids, and telecommunication networks. Welcome to Background Briefing, Naj Mashkati.
Thank you very much, Mr. Masters, and hello to you and to your listeners.
Well, thanks for joining us, Naj. And the work that you do, which I just read your bio, all of that applies in many ways to what's happening down in Louisiana, where you have the grid down, the electrical grid down. You have huge petrochemical plants and refineries there, etc. So what do you make of this latest hurricane and the damage that it's done?
That reminds me again of Hurricane Katrina, which hit Louisiana and unfortunately New Orleans very badly in early 2000. But what you just explained, the grid down, problems with the plants and different facilities because of lack of electricity and the impact of the natural disaster, just reminds me of what happened in Texas just a few months ago when we lost the grid over there because of that extreme cold. These events are called extreme events. They used to be really extreme. I accentuate the word extreme. But as you see that those events are not becoming very or not staying very extremes, they are becoming, unfortunately, new normal. And the common denominator for their causation is the climate change. If you look at the recent IPCC report, they say that exactly as a result of the climate change, these extreme events are becoming more frequent with more intensity and bigger bang. And what we see over here in Louisiana, unfortunately, it could be part of a trend that we will be facing more and more in the future.
So is there a gap between the understanding of the people that run these utility companies like Entergy down in Louisiana and others in Texas, for example? Texas is not even a part of the overall national grid. It deregulated its grid. Are the people that are running these big electrical companies and power grids in this country, are they not in touch with the reality of climate change? Is there a gap between the reality of climate change and business as normal with electricity providers?
That's a very good point. Again, I'm talking from my vantage point as a researcher that I study these systems and their systems failure. As I may have mentioned before, I have developed a graduate course, which I've been teaching at USC. I'm very proud of my students there. It's called Complex System Safety and Resiliency. In this graduate course, we study this phenomena of like nuclear accident, like Fukushima, Chernobyl, and also this issue of the grid resiliency. What we are facing here, Mr. Ian Masters, is we have a mindset from the utilities that they can fend off these extreme events by, for example, developing or putting the power lines under the ground. But again, we need a paradigm shift because we have a big gorilla in the room, big elephant in the room, and that's called climate change. That affects everything that we have used to do it. The business as usual is changed. We really need to have a paradigm shift. And the same way that we have improved our structures and prepared for the earthquake, we need to improve the resiliency of our electricity generation, electricity transmission, and electricity distribution. This paradigm shift is badly needed. I don't know if the utility executives and even the federal regulators like FERC are considering that as a total system that they need to look at that or not. I haven't seen that much activity in that. The other point that I would like to make is I think, based on my judgment or my reading, we are suffering from a phenomena which is called the tyranny of a small decision. Tyranny of a small decision is a concept which was in economics, which was developed by late Arfled Khan in 1966. It basically says that when we are facing some changes, in that case, transportation, and that we need really to stand back and not to make a small remedial decision, band-aid after band-aid. We need to sit back and really look at the total system here. That's what I say, that mindset that we have had, in my judgment, suffers from tyranny of a small decision. And we need to really, in light of IPCC report and light of realities, the utilities, they need to look at this issue of resiliency for the generation, transmission, and distribution.
And again, I'm speaking with Nash Mishkati, who is a professor at the Sunny Astani Department of Civil Environmental Engineering and a professor in the Daniel J. Epstein Department of Industrial and Systems Engineering at the University of Southern California, where he's an expert on safety and risk reduction in such systems as the five modes of transportation and their facilities, energy generation plants, petrochemical plants and refineries, transmission and distribution grids, and telecommunication networks. So given that we've had these powerful winds from Hurricane Ida absolutely devastate the grids and topple the transmission lines in the state of Louisiana, and then you mentioned last winter in Texas where the entire grid froze and people were without electricity for a long time with their pipes bursting, etc. And then in California, we've had massive forest fires caused by the electrical grids basically not being underground, I suppose, as you were mentioning. So it's evident that is happening, and if these extreme weather events will get worse, that's what scientists predict. So what about the possibility then of decentralizing the grid? People like the Tesla company that build electric cars, they're working on solar roofs for houses so each house can have its own electrical system without being tied to the grid and ride out any of these storms, etc. Is that the way to go?
I think that's a step in the right direction. That may take care of the electricity need and electricity usage of small households, and that they can basically run their appliances with the battery, generate electricity for their air conditioning, and maybe charge their electric car with that. But that, in my humble opinion, doesn't solve the issue of the base load that we need to run major facilities like, for example, our light rail system, or a facility like LAX with all the electrical need that it has and other industrial devices that we have. We still need massive amount of electricity, and it needs to be generated and transmitted and distributed. Yes, the decentralization is a good solution. Basically, it provides a backup for the homes, and it could even be a source of income for some people, that they could sell the excess electricity to the grid. But I don't think that distributed generation at this small scale could solve the base load need that we have.
Well, but it would take a lot of pressure off the base load, wouldn't it, if households had their own independently generating electrical systems in this decentralized way?
Absolutely. For example, during the summer heat waves, or not necessarily summer, we have had some recent situation that we had extreme heat, they could basically use their own electricity and, as you said, take off the load, reduce the load from the grid, and the grid can support the like public facilities and others. There is also another source of electricity generation which has been seriously considered for the state of California and for the East Coast states, and that is what is called floating wind turbine. this floating wind turbine, which has been used in Europe, now being seriously considered both in federal water off the coast of California and in state water. That could be adding another good, reliable source of electricity generation to us, which so far has not been looked into that or has not been available.
So has there been any work done on assessing the cost, for example, here in California, of what the big electric company PG&E is responsible for, these massive fires that have caused so much damage, and of course these vast forest fires not only destroying human lives and property, they also generate more CO2, and as you destroy trees, you lose a source of the sink for CO2, so it's a sort of lose-lose situation. How much damage do you think has been done in terms of what it would cost to bury these lines so that you wouldn't have PG&E and other electric companies causing forest fires?
I remember, Mr. Masters, there was a very good article in New York Times a few months ago by Mr. Ivan Penn. And in that article that I have it somewhere saved, clipped and saved, there was some very interesting numbers about the cost estimation, for example, for burying these major transmission lines underground. And it's over several billions of dollars. But unfortunately, I don't remember the exact number. But if you and your listeners are interested, if you run a Google search on Ivan Penn, New York Times, and cost of burying the power lines, you will find that article.
And again, I'm speaking with Naj Mishkati, who's a professor at the Sunny Astani Department of Civil Environmental Engineering and a professor in the Daniel J. Epstein Department of Industrial and Systems Engineering at the University of Southern California, where he's an expert on safety and risk reduction in such systems as the five modes of transportation and their facilities, energy generation plants, petrochemical plants and refineries, transmission and distribution grids, and telecommunication networks. Well, where are the investments coming from, though? In other words, in terms of getting off the grid and being self-sufficient as a household, and the decentralization, how quickly do you see that happening? I mean, I mentioned that Tesla has these solar roofs. I don't know what other competition there is, but would it be possible to accelerate that pace so that people down in New Orleans, for example, and in Texas and here in California would still have electricity in spite of extreme weather?
I think it could be with all sort of tax incentives and tax write-off and subsidies which are developed. For example, now when you put solar system, solar collector and solar panel on your houses, you get some sort of a relief on the tax and maybe electricity bill and that. And there is also could be some incentive that coming from the federal government for that. And again, this is precisely the one that I mentioned to you. We need to get away from that tyranny of a small decision and look at the big picture. Look at all these small generators that can be added, providing incentive, providing subsidies. Subsidies, federal subsidies could be another one. I don't know. The new Biden infrastructure plan, there is a lot of money for grid and electrical cars and that, but I'm not sure if this issue has been addressed in this or not.
But what about changing the culture in these big companies like the Department of Water and Power and Edison and other, and Entergy down in Louisiana and, of course, in Texas, where they basically took steps backwards in deregulating the grid?
Being honest with you, changing the culture of some of these very deeply entrenched electric utilities in some states is very much like changing the path of a major supertanker. And it's not very easy. I have done a lot of studies on the safety culture of some of these major utilities like our PG&E, Pacific Gas and Electric. And you see that day, we had a major pipeline explosion in San Bruno, which was caused, unfortunately, by primarily the organizational culture of PG&E. And that didn't change its culture. Other fires, they didn't change its culture. And I really don't know sometimes how could you change the culture of some electric, major electric utility companies. I'm puzzled, being honest with you. Again, if you want me to tell you about our studies about Fukushima accident, Fukushima accident in Japan was a preventable accident. Yes, there was earthquake. Yes, there was tsunami 45 minutes later. But Fukushima Daiichi and Daini that got crippled, and I visited both in 2011, it could have been prevented. And the culture of Tokyo Electric Power Company, the corporate culture of that utility, according to many studies and our own research, is the main culprit. As you see, changing the culture of utilities are not very easy.
Well, Naj Mashkati, I thank you very much for joining us here today. I appreciate it very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Masters. Nice talking with you.
Likewise. And again, I've been speaking with Naj Mashkati, who's a professor at the Sunny Astani Department of Civil Environmental Engineering and a professor at the Daniel J. Epstein Department of Industrial and Systems Engineering at the University of Southern California, where he's an expert on safety and risk reduction in such systems as the five modes of transportation and their facilities, energy generation plants, petrochemical plants and refineries, transmission and distribution grids, and telecommunications networks. We're going to take a brief station break. We're back looking into what can be done in the face of a refusal by the Chinese Communist government to cooperate and provide evidence about the origins of the COVID-19 pandemic. If it keeps on raining, that is going to break. If it keeps on raining, that is going to break. When the levee breaks, have no place to stay. Welcome back. I'm Ian Masters, and this is Background Briefing, available 24/7 at backgroundbriefing.org. And joining us now, Dr. Stanley Perlman, a professor of microbiology and immunology at the University of Iowa, who has studied coronavirus pathogenesis for four decades. Welcome to Background Briefing, Dr. Stanley Perlman.
Thank you. I'm happy to be here.
Well, thanks for joining us. And I'm following up. I did an interview yesterday with Shannon Bennett, virologist, head of the California Academy of Sciences. And her conclusion was largely that it's more likely to be a zoonotic leap that caused the COVID-19 pandemic, but there's no evidence to suggest otherwise in terms of a lab leak. Well, the report, of course, that came out, the two-page declassified summary that came out on Friday, essentially says that without cooperation from China, we'll essentially never know. So is that the problem, that we'll never know whether it was a lab accident simply because we can't get to that evidence without help from China? And that's about the last thing they're likely to do, isn't it?
Well, I think it's really confounded also by the fact that we're almost 2 years into the pandemic now. So whatever information there was is becoming more and more harder and harder to access. So if you wanted to prove either one of these mechanisms, one, yeah, the lab information might be more stable if we had more access to it from late 2019 or early 2020. Certainly proving the natural origin is going to take hunting in the wild for bat viruses that look more similar to SARS-CoV-2 than the ones we have now. finding intermediate animals now, it's very hard because humans are infected everywhere. So even if we find an intermediate animal that looks like it could have been a precursor, it's always hard to rule out that it hasn't been infected by people. So I think the bottom line is, yes, it's going to be very hard to figure all this out. And the other thing I think about is that even if this were a lab leak, and I also tend to think it's more likely a natural origin for the virus, it's what will it take to prove a negative result? How will people be satisfied that it's not a lab leak? That's going to also be a very hard issue for those who are inclined to think that it is a lab leak. So I tended to think that the report was more or less correct. It showed how complicated and difficult this is going to be.
Well, of course, the bottom line, I guess, to summarize the findings was that four intelligence community agencies and the National Intelligence Council at the CIA assessed with low confidence that COVID pandemic was likely caused by a zoonotic leap from an animal to a human. But one of the agencies assessed with moderate confidence that the infections could have been come from a lab-associated incident involving experimentation, animal handling, or sampling by the Wuhan Institute of Virology. So I guess there you have four saying with low confidence that it's a zoonotic leap, and one saying with moderate confidence that it could be a lab accident. So it's sort of inconclusive is hardly a sufficient description, right?
Yeah, no, I agree with you. I think it's fair, though, in the sense that it is inconclusive. We haven't found the evidence. We haven't found the intermediates. We haven't found the necessary data yet to say that this is for sure a natural, came from a natural source. The other thing I wanted to say is, before I finish that sentence even, is that almost all of the thinking out there is that the origin is really settled, that this is a bat virus. And the issue is just how did it get into human populations? So that's, I think, where we're having the discussion. I know there are some people out there who still think this is bioengineered, but I think that's really unlikely because it's so difficult. So it's still a bat virus, and it's just whether it leaked from an animal in a market or it leaked from a lab worker working with it. I think it's very hard to distinguish those possibilities at this point.
Well, there has been some reporting on some miners were shoveling bat guano in a cave down in the south near Vietnam. And apparently the horseshoe bat, that's where it comes from. And that several of them fell ill and that they had COVID-like symptoms. Some died, and there were lots of people from the Wuhan Institute of Virology that treated these patients and took samples, etc., which they then studied back. That's been one of the suggestions that would indicate that this virus was inside the miners long enough to mutate. Is that the case here? You know, relating now to, of course, to this Delta variant that's ravaging the country. What is the relationship between a virus and how it inhabits human beings and then is able to mutate and become more deadly?
Yeah, I think this is really important. We know a lot about this from the SARS epidemic, where we know the virus came from bats. We never found the exact virus in bats, but we found similar ones. But differently than SARS-CoV-2 or COVID-19, we isolated virus from intermediate animals. So we could watch the virus change in those intermediate animals and then watch it change in people once it got a foothold. So yes, the virus does change with time, and it adapts to being, I think, a better transmissible virus. That's really its goal, to infect more people. And that's what I think SARS-CoV was doing before it was eradicated. So in terms of the miners, it's a little hard for me to understand it exactly, because the whatever virus it was, this coronavirus had pretty strong ability to infect humans from the get-go, it looks like. We don't really know so much about what a virus was specifically we're talking about here. At that point, the only viruses that the Institute of Virology has published, or the viruses that have been isolated from the Yunnan Cave, are close to SARS-CoV-2, but there's still 4% off, which is 1,200 nucleotides, which in virus geography is very, very far, several years' worth of mutation. So The issue about how viruses are mutating now is quite curious, because in fact several mutations are being incorporated into the virus at the same time. So it's as if the virus is in a place where it can mutate, which viruses always do, but then without it being eradicated. Most of us who get infected eradicate the virus very quickly, so that there's not that much time for the virus to mutate and then become a strain that is able to both be transmitted to another person and then transmitted widely. So there's a lot of unknowns here, exactly how this is happening.
And again, I'm speaking with Dr. Stanley Perlman, a professor of microbiology and immunology at the University of Iowa, who has studied coronavirus pathogenesis for four decades. So in terms of, as a scientist and somebody that's intimately involved with this very issue that we're talking about, the pandemic and coronaviruses, how important is it to get to the bottom of this origin of, it looks like we never will get to the bottom of it, whether it was a zoonotic leap or whether it was a lab accident because of the lack of cooperation from China. But how important is it from your point of view to get to the bottom of the origin?
Yeah, so I think it's really important for several points of view. One is, if it, as I was saying before, I think it came from bats originally. So we need to, we want to make sure that our precautions for taking care of zoonotic samples are as good as they could be. And we want to be sure that people are aware of when they're crossing into the biological sphere of bats that they have to take the proper precautions, because we don't, especially in the southern part of China, we don't know, in Southeast Asia, we don't know what bats are carrying, and we know that they could carry coronaviruses. So that's one piece that we may revisit, even independent of whether we discover how the virus crossed into human populations. And then the second part is, if this turned out to be a lab problem, and we'd want to make sure that lab techniques are done as carefully as possible. And I have to say, in the U.S., there are lab accidents, but the vast majority of them don't really amount to much. But we all have to be aware of those who work in BSL-3 that we need to be careful. I think this is taught to us continuously, and we're paying a lot of attention to it. So whether there'll be actually incredible changes, I don't know. But if we figure out the origin, it's already made us think about all of these issues. But I think from many points of view, it would be good to know exactly how it got there, so in the future, we could prevent this from happening again.
So there's always been a lot of cooperation among scientists around the world that sort of transcends nationalism and governments. But is there the same openness in connections between U.S. scientists and Chinese scientists? Because, you know, the Chinese government has been really quite aggressive in attacking anybody that even asks for an inquiry or an investigation. It goes back to early on when the pandemic was happening in last year, in the early stages, when the Australian government called on the World Health Organization to do an investigation into the origins. The Chinese government slapped tariffs on Australian goods. And then more recently, of course, they've accused the United States of being behind this pandemic, with some, you know, bioweapon research at Fort Detrick, Maryland, having started the whole pandemic, which is, of course, an absurd claim. But the fact that it's coming from the government of the People's Republic of China is pretty disturbing in itself. So what's your understanding, Stanley Perlman, of the relationship between scientists as a community? Has it been affected by the politicization of this issue?
Yeah, so I think that scientists still are communicating with each other, but the openness has to have been affected. We can't have the same kind of open exchange, at least at some levels. I know we still have meetings with our Chinese colleagues, and we invite them to our meetings, and we go to their meetings. So most of it's still intact. But when you have when one has a government like the Chinese government setting down rules and opinions like this, it has to impact the transparency of what we can say to each other. We still try to do the best we can, and certainly things are not being suppressed, but it's harder. There's no question about that.
And again, I'm speaking with Dr. Stanley Perlman, a professor of microbiology and immunology at the University of Iowa, who has studied coronavirus pathogenesis for four decades. So is there any path forward here? Are we just, because there was a certain expectation when President Biden announced that he was going to do this 90-day study into the origins of this pandemic, that we'd at least make some progress, but it looks like we're pretty stalled here, and I'm not sure whether there is a path forward. And as this Delta variant gets worse and worse around the globe, I mean, as bad as it is here in the United States, it's barely taken a foothold in the rest of the world, and here we are getting booster shots or being asked to get booster shots when people in the third world haven't even had any shots at all. And that wouldn't that indicate that this pandemic will grow and grow, and maybe, you know, the epsilon and whatever the next variant that comes along might even be worse than the current Delta one?
Yeah, I think that it's certainly true that the Delta has been much more transmissible than anyone would have expected, and it is a big problem. And I agree that we want to get the whole world vaccinated. And I have questions, too, about the booster shots. That's being considered at the ACIP just in a few hours here in the U.S. This is going to be discussed. That's on Monday afternoon. But in terms of whether we can go forward, I think that the WHO, the SAGO plan, which is this committee that is supposed to again investigate the origins and how it got into human populations, and talking to Chinese as well as other officials around the world, I think all we can do is just keep investigating as best we can, following up all leads, getting as much information as we can from late 2019 in different parts of China and different parts of Southeast Asia, and continuing to pursue the paths that I think are apparent to most of us on how to figure out where the virus came from. At the end, I don't disagree with your tentative conclusion that this may be very difficult and may not come to fruition. But I have to I think we have to keep trying, because we really want to know. In terms of the virus mutating, the one thing I still think, and this is not as clear as it was to me a little while ago, but the coronaviruses are not influenza viruses. They don't tend to mutate as much or in the same way. So that I think there's a structural limitation in how much change the virus can incorporate and still be as transmissible and as it needs to be. Virulence, killing people, of course, is not its goal. Transmission is its goal. So I think there's a limit, but boy, we haven't reached it yet.
So just in closing then, Stanley Perlman, what is the meeting that you just mentioned and the group that's holding this meeting about booster shots?
That's today, the Center for Disease Control, the CDC, and this is the American, the Advisory Committee on Immunization Practices. The meeting began at 10 a.m. Eastern time in the U.S. and will end, I think, at 4:30. And the last hour or so will be on booster shots, and it's open to the public. So anyone who wants to hear it streaming can through the internet.
And so what's your sense about booster shots? Because that's a question a lot of our listeners are asking.
Yeah, so booster shots, there's no question that they boost antibody titers, but that's really what we know best. And they seem, but a study that just came out yesterday said they seem to decrease the amount of severe disease compared to people who had only gotten two boosters. That was done in Israel, two shots, and that was done in Israel. So that's true. But whether it actually is going to be helpful to the general population isn't clear to me. My personal feeling is that it should be boosters, shots should be given to certain populations, maybe to people who have poor immune systems and didn't respond well. I don't know that they'll respond that much better here, but they some seem to respond to a third booster and groups like that. And for the general population, we may get a boost in antibody response, but we don't know how long that'll last. There's a lot of things that mitigate against general approval of this. But I think the jury's still out. I mean, we're still learning more and more. And what the other thing you said was really critical. We have to have more than 5% of Africa vaccinated for this virus to be under control. We can't have it going rampant throughout the world and have the U.S. and Western Europe fully vaccinated, but virus still being able to grow and mutate in many different scenarios, settings.
Well, just in closing, I mean, it's depressing to think that we still have, even though the Pfizer vaccine has now been approved by the FDA and it's no longer experimental, still you've got this anti-vaccine movement. You've got the governor of Florida, Ron DeSantis, selling T-shirts, "Don't Fauci my Florida." I find it all just mind-boggling, this backlash, this flat-earth kind of attitude that's out there.
Yeah, I agree with you.
So, I don't want to end on a depressing note, but I guess it must be frustrating from your point of view as a scientist.
Yeah, well, it's also very clear that the vaccines are doing a great job. So even when we talk about these breakthroughs with the Delta virus, when you start looking at the baseline there, it's really small amount of breakthrough and very small amount of people getting ill or be going to the hospital. And those groups that do have those problems are ones where we know their immunity might have been weaker to begin with, or the immunity waned. So that's why we can be smart about this and figure out who should get a booster. But for the vast majority of us, these vaccines are working very well. And that's really the hopeful sign of all this.
Well, Dr. Stanley Perlman, I thank you so much for joining us here today.
My pleasure. Thank you for having me.
And again, I've been speaking with Dr. Stanley Perlman, a professor of microbiology and immunology at the University of Iowa, who has studied coronavirus pathogenesis for 4 decades. This has been Background Briefing. I'm Ian Masters. I'd like to thank producer Graham Fitzgibbon, and this program is available for podcasting at backgroundbriefing.org, where you can sign up for our email updates as well as subscribe wherever you get your podcasts. If you like this program, you can help us reach more listeners by taking a moment to rate and review us on iTunes, Google Play, iHeartRadio, or wherever you get your podcasts. And please do share the program with friends and family and colleagues on Twitter and Facebook. And I'll be back again tomorrow with another Background Briefing. Bye for now.
A young girl tosses a coin in the wishing well.